declare you're awesome. Even in the good times and the bad times. Awesome. Woohoo. And holy. Oh my God. Yes, he is. He's holy. Put him in his place. He's holy. And forever he will reign. Somebody give him a hand clap of praise today. Amen. I don't care what you're going through, what situation you're in. God is still awesome. And he's able. Come on, somebody in a pool. He's able to pull you out of whatever you're in. Amen. And lift you up high. Amen. Keep being encouraged. Amen. God bless you. There's a word today from the Lord. Amen. Amen.
About this time, a man and a woman from the tribe Levi got married. The woman became pregnant and gave birth to a son. She saw that he was special. He was a special baby and kept him hidden for 3 months. But when she could no longer hide him, she got a basket made of papyrus reeds and waterproofed it with tar and pitch. She put the baby in the basket and laid it among the reeds along the bank of the Nile River. The baby sister then stood at a distance, watching to see what would happen to him. Soon Pharaoh's daughter came down to bathe in the river, and her attendants walked along the river bank. When the princess saw the basket among the reeds, she sent her maid to go get it for her. When the princess opened it, she saw the baby. The boy was crying, and she felt sorry for him. "This must be one of the Hebrew baby children," she said. Then the baby sister approached the princess. Should I go and find one of the Hebrew women to nurse the baby for you?" she asked. "Yes, do," the princess replied. So the girl went and called the baby's mother. "Take this baby and nurse him for me," the princess told the baby's mother. "I will pay you for your help." So the woman took her baby home and nursed him. Later, when the boy was older, his mother brought him back to Pharaoh's daughter, who adopted him as her own son. The princess named him Moses, for she exclaimed, "I lifted him out of the water."
Amen. Amen. We want to thank Jane and Carol for reading. We give God praise for him this morning.
Amen.
This morning, we want to speak with you quickly on the message. He will do whatever it takes. He will, that is, he, God, will do whatever it takes. And you may say, whatever it takes for what? He'll do whatever it takes to save you. He'll do whatever it takes to deliver you. He will do whatever it takes to restore you, to heal your brokenness, to destroy the enemy attacked against you. God will do whatever it takes to bring you from where you are now to where he wants you to be. Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, we thank you right now, God, as we've come forth to come to bring this word, oh God. We ask for understanding, oh God. We ask for revelation, oh God. We ask for your word to be manifested, oh God. Lord, let this word bring life to someone who is drowning. Let this word bring life to someone who is broken, oh God. Lord, heal somebody who is bereaved this morning. Lord, let this word bring hope, oh God. Hope, oh God, and have faith, oh God, to know that you will do, oh God, exceedingly abundantly, more than what we can even ask or think according to thy word, oh God. Lord, let your word have free course right now this morning. Lord, let somebody be saved this morning. Let somebody get restored in their spirit, oh God. Lord, we ask you right now, God, to, Lord, touch me, oh God, as I bring forth your word, oh God. Lord, give me strength. Give me clarity of speech, oh God. Lord, cause my words to be clear. Let the anointing flow through me from the very crown of my head to the sole of my feet. And Lord, we give your name praise, glory, and honor, for it belongs to you. Thank you, Jesus. We want to come out to Lord just to greet each and every one of you. We are come and we are thankful, oh God, for each and every person who have logged on. We were on our way to the church and the pastor stopped us and he said, "Go back home," because we want to make sure that everything is okay, that all our members are protected. And we thank God that we still have technology that we can greet and we can meet each person right there in their home, right there in their location. And we thank God for that. So this morning, I want to take this time out to ask for your prayers for Deacon Roger Green and his family. And we understand that Deacon Green lost his father. And we want you to know that when they say lost, you know, when I hear people say lost, it kind of, it disturbs me. My heart goes out to the family. My heart goes out to the ones that he touched their lives. My heart go out to the ones that are grieving right now. Even Sister Erica Ray lost her brother Tiger, and also Sister Bobby Lashley lost her brother. We're going through a lot of loss, but when they say we lost, the one thing I need you to know about this morning, that when we say lost, we say that means we don't know where they are. We don't understand where they are. So we don't want to say we lost them. We're going to say them because we know where they are. We know where they are. So we just want to celebrate God for the victory of the celebration of life of Deacon Roger Green's father and Sister Bobby Lash's brother and also Sister Erica Ray's brother. We're praying for the family as they go through during this time of bereavement. We love you and we're praying for you and we're standing in the gap for you. And we just give God praise. We understand that the scripture that was read this morning talked about Moses. And it talked about how Moses came about. We understand that Pharaoh had made a decree. And in the decree, he said that, you know, the Israelites are becoming great. They're becoming many. And we cannot let them become so great and so many that they begin to overtake us. Overtake the Egyptians, and we don't want that to happen. So I want to put out a decree to all the midwives, to all the people that's going to bring these boys and these children into the world. Anytime he made the decree that anytime that a boy child is born, anytime that you are delivering an Israelite baby, and you notice that the baby is a boy, what I need you to do is to kill the baby. Do not let the baby live, because we don't want the Israelites to become strong with all these strong men and become many and they overtake us, which are the Hebrews. We do not want this to happen. So he made a decree, and the midwives had to obey it because that was the decree from the overseer, the king. And what happened is that Moses has a way of getting through the decree. And one thing I want to share with you today, that your circumstance may not look the best. And your circumstance may not look the greatest. But you got to understand that God is going to make a way of escape for you. And I want you to know, as we said in the title, he'll do whatever it takes to heal you. He'll do whatever it takes to save you. He'll do whatever it takes to bring you out. And don't think because of what you're going through that God is not able to deliver you. I want you to know that he will never allow your situation to be bigger than your victory. You need to tell somebody that. My situation will never be bigger than my victory. God is going to use my situation to strengthen somebody else. And as Pastor Carol has given us the theme, reach, and that means that we have got to leave the pews and leave the seats and go to the streets and begin to reach people and do whatever it takes, as God has done for us. He said that he desired for our soul to prosper. He desired for us to be in good health. He said, I did not come to condemn this world, but I come that this world through me might be saved. And so God is going to do whatever it takes, because he has purpose for your life. He has purpose to bring you from where you are to where he wants you to be. And your situation and your circumstance is not great enough to stop what God has for your life. He said, the plans that I have for your lives, oh God. He said, he's talking to you. He said, even before you was conceived in your mother's womb, I had a plan for your life. I had some things that I was going to use you. It was some people that's going to be saved through your voice. It's some people that's going to come off of drugs because of you. And I'm not going to let the enemy snuff you out before you get to your best place, till you get to the wealthy place, until you fulfill your assignment. So what God had to do is he had to speak, and he had to speak through those midwives, because midwives, my God, midwives are the people that help you come through. It helps you come from the birthing canal into this world. And that midwives are very important, because they get you from the womb, come on somebody, to outside of the womb. And so, excuse me, the midwives have a very important job. And now they're being told that they cannot allow the male children to live. And this became a problem, because God still will anoint people on the enemy's camp. Let me say that again. God will anoint people on the enemy camp to make sure that you're where you need to be in God. He'll make somebody on the outside bless you. Come on, somebody. He'll call somebody who have no knowns of you, don't know nothing about you, but they'll just walk up to you and say, I don't know why I'm blessing. Moses. When the midwives was getting ready to deliver Moses, the midwives were not letting these boys die. She could not kill them. So therefore, Moses, he escaped. Won't God give you a way of escape? Right when the enemy meant it for your bad, God have a way of turning it around. And sometimes we can't let ourselves talk ourselves out of our breakthrough. We can't let ourselves talk us out and be defeated. We are more than conquerors. And I'm so glad that Moses' mother decided that, you know I can't keep him. I know that they're going to try to kill him. But the best thing that I can do is to try to spare his life. So what she did, she put him in a basket and she sealed it real tight. And what God is doing is that when he set us apart, he's taking us out of the mainstream and he's putting us in a place. Let's just call that place a basket. A place where he's going to groom us. A place where he's going to build us. A place that he's going to keep us as we go through the incubator stage of being grown, of being brought forth. He'll put us in the basket. And like Moses' mother did, not only did she put him in the basket, she sealed it with tar so that the water won't seep in and drown him. And what God will do in the midst of us, he'll set us apart. That means he'll sanctify us and he'll put us in a place where the enemy cannot hurt us. He'll put us in a place where the enemy cannot overtake us. And then he'll seal it with his word. He'll seal it with his anointing. He'll seal it with his healing so nothing can come in and do your heart no harm. Nothing can come in and destroy the life. Why? Because he'll do whatever it takes to make sure that you live. Because when you live, others live. When you live, nations live. When you reach out to one person, that person gonna reach out to another person. And we'll begin to reach beyond our reach. And we'll begin to touch lives that we would have never known about if we'd have died in our situation. Thank God that Moses' mother seen the promise on Moses' life. I'm so glad. And not only that, God will do whatever it takes. He'll cause the enemy to work in your favor. And when he did, the sister of Moses began to watch out for that baby. Watch out for that basket. Because she knew her brother was in that basket. And she began to watch to see what would happen to that basket. Let me tell you somebody. God has assigned somebody that's connected to you to watch out. Because they know the promise on your life. And they're going to make sure you make it to your destination. There's some people that God is going to put into your life that people ain't going to understand why that person is so close to you. People are not going to understand why that person walking so close to you, because that person have an assignment and that person going to make sure that you make it to your destination. When you want to give up, that person going to say, oh no, there's a calling on your life and God is about to move you from where you are to where he wants you to be. And I'm so glad that God used Miriam to take Moses and keep an eye on Moses. And so Miriam knew her assignment. The problem with us is that we forget what we're called for. You were not called, oh God, to make sure that people be perfect. You were not called to make people do what you want them to do. But you're called to do your assignment. You're called to obey. And maybe sometimes it's not you that's going to climb the ladder. But maybe God is calling you to hold a ladder for somebody else to go higher. And when they go higher, you go higher. So I'm so glad that God is equipping us in our mindset that we won't be moved, but we won't be moved and we won't be distracted, but we'll hold on to our assignment, because God is going to do whatever it takes. If he got to go against someone, if he got to move some stuff out of the way, if he got to cause you to lose your job for you to recognize him, if he got to cause you to move to this place to speak life into somebody in that area, God will do whatever. He'll do exceedingly abundantly more than what we can even ask or think. So what he did, Moses had a purpose. Moses had an assignment, and Moses would have never made it to the burning bush if he had not put in that basket. He'd have never been able to hold his sword up and part the Red Sea if he had not was put in that basket. Moses would not have been able to lead them through the wilderness if he had not been placed in that basket. You may be wondering, why am I here? Why have God placed me in this situation? Why did he place me in this circumstance? He's building you so you can reach out to somebody else. That does not mean that you're not going to go through some things. That does not mean that the enemy is not going to try to attack you. That does not mean that you won't suffer life. But God said, I love you too much. I love you too much. And I shall not let the enemy overtake you. That's what he told the enemy when he came up against Job. He said, you can do whatever you want, but his life you cannot have. God is speaking to you this morning. You may feel depressed. You may have been going through some things. COVID may have taken some people out that you love. But God said that don't quit, because anything that's easy won't last. And anything that lasts won't be easy. You got to hold on to what you know about God. And I'm so glad that Miriam washed that basket. Maybe God have you watching something. Maybe God have you watching somebody. Maybe God have you pointing to somebody that you had no clue that why you was holding on to them. But you watch it. Watch as well as pray. Because that is an important assignment. And when the maid of the princess seen the basket, the maid told her, he drew that basket out of the water. That's what Moses meant. That it was lifted up out of the water. So he lifted it out of the water. And then when they lifted the baby out of the water, see, Moses was supposed to be lifted out of that water, and they should have killed him, because they recognized that he was a Hebrew baby. He was an Israelite. And they recognized that he was not supposed to live. But let me tell you something. Let me share this with you. If God be for you, he's better than the whole world against you. And he'll do whatever it takes to make sure that you live and shall not die and declare the works of the Lord. That's called reaching. When you go tell somebody, I was down and now I'm up. I was broken, now I'm placed back together again. I was hurt, now I'm healed. You got to be able to tell somebody. So the maid pulled the baby out of the water, and the Bible said that he looked down and he said, this is a Hebrew baby. What are we going to do with him? The princess' heart was filled with compassion. She looked at this newborn baby and she said to the girl, and before the princess could even ask around, the girl Miriam, the sister of Moses, knew her assignment. And even though you're the oldest, it don't mean that you're the leader. Sometimes you got to serve those that are older than you. You got to serve those that are younger than you. Maybe you got to serve those that don't have as much knowledge as you. But if they're called, you got to keep to your assignment, because God is going to do whatever it takes to get you from here to where he wants you to be. So Miriam said, hello, do you want me to go find a Hebrew woman? Do you want me to go find a mother that can nurse this baby? Let me show you how God will hook it up. God will sanctify this thing. He'll cause this thing to work for your good. And he told Moses, and she looked at Moses. She said, yes. The princess said, yes. Go find me a mother that can nurse this baby. And look how God worked it out. Look how God worked it out. The same baby, that the same mother that had to give up her baby because the thought of being killed. The same mother that had to put her baby in a basket. The same mother had to risk the thought of her baby being killed. That baby, because of the course of God, because of who God is, and because what God would do to save you, what God would do to deliver you, he calls the own mother to be the one to be able to nurse her own baby. So the mother of Moses took Moses back home. The mother of Moses had the opportunity to nurse Moses to love. You will endure bumps. You will endure heartaches. You will endure shakes in shaky areas. But hold on and don't let go of your faith. Hold on. It gets difficult sometimes. It gets hard sometimes. But the enemy comes to kill, steal, and destroy. But God said, I come that you might have life and have life more abundantly. So he decided to do it. Is he decided to save Moses? And he will decide to save you. He saved you when you was out there in the world of drugs. He saved you when you was in the world of adultery. He saved you when you was out there stealing. He saved you when you was gossiping and backbiting. He saved you when you had unforgiveness in your heart. He'll save you. What will God do? He'll leave the 99, as they said in Luke chapter 15. He left the 99. Oh my God. The man left the 99 and went to find that lost one. God will do whatever it takes to save you. If he had to put your flag on your back, he'll do whatever it takes to save you. And the next thing God will do, he'll do whatever it takes to heal you. So not only will he save you, he's going to heal you, because you've been walking around with brokenness. You've been walking around with cancer. You've been walking around with diabetes. You've been walking around with lupus. You've been walking around with drug addictions. You've been walking around with kidney failure. But God said, I'm going to heal you. He said that he's going to use people to reach out to you. And that's what we're going to do. We're going to leave the street, the pews. We're going to leave the seats. And we're going to go in the streets. And we're going to begin to lay hands on the sick. And they're going to recover. We're going to believe their God. And we're going to speak life unto those that are broken. We're going to speak life to those that are sick in their body. You shall be healed. You shall be healed. Death has no hand. Death has no authority over you. You shall live and not die and declare the works of the Lord. Healing is coming to your children. Healing is coming for. He's using you to bring help to those that are broken. He's using you to speak in the midst of your pain and cause somebody to be healed. He's using you to look at the people and not look at yourself. God is able. He's able to bring you out. He's able to deliver you. I don't know who I'm talking to today, but you shall not be moved, but you shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that bring forth good fruit. I dare you to trust God this morning. I dare you to trust God in your situation. I dare you to shake yourself and pull yourself together. You shall come out of this. You shall be victorious. You shall be the head and not the tail. You shall be the lender and not the borrower. You shall be the hand. You shall walk in your wealthy place. Everything that your hands touch, God's going to bless it. Everything that you put your mind to, God's going to cause it to prosper. So God is doing it today. He's doing it for you today. And I want you to know that in this life, you're going to go through some stuff. But as God did Moses, he's going to do the same for you. He's going to make sure that he saved you. He's going to make sure that nobody take advantage of his purpose he got for your life. And the next thing he's going to do is he's going to heal you. He's going to make sure that your body is healed from the crown of your head to the sole of your feet. Somebody on this radio line, somebody on this Facebook is asking God for a healing. And God said, I'm going to heal you because you got purpose. I'm going to heal you because I'm God. I'm going to heal you because you are work in progress. And I'm going to need you. And the next thing God is going to do, not only has he came to save you, not only did he come to heal you, then he want to use you. He want to use you for his glory. He wants you to go to the hedges and the highways, teaching them all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son. And you don't need to be conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by renewing of your mind. And everything ain't going to always go your way, but just know that God is going to do whatever it takes to get you from the place that you are to the place that you want to be. So as you go through whatever you're going through in your life right now, remember God has three things that he's going to do for me. And he's going to do whatever it takes for it to take place. He's going to save me, he's going to heal me, and then he's going to use me. And I thank God today that God is using us right now. He's using us to go to the nations. He's using us to bring life to those that are broken. He's using us right now to use our things that we're going through to help somebody else. God is using us. Don't forsake the promises that's on your life. Don't forsake and remember that if God is able to do it for the one man who left 99 sheep to go get that one, what about that father who left everything? And when the prodigal son came back home, even though the prodigal son did the things he was supposed to do, he went out to the clubs, he did what he wanted to do, but when he came back home, a good father won't turn their back on their child. A good father won't quit when things get hard. A good father won't let their children down. A good father will receive them no matter what they've done in life. And I'm so thankful that the man of God said that he that was, I thought was dead, is alive. He that was lost, now he's found. So God said, whatever it takes for me to get you back home, to get you back to the place of healing, to get you back to the place of deliverance, I'm going to do whatever it takes. So if you ain't a basket right now, don't get discouraged. Don't get discouraged, because God is about to call somebody to find you. And when they find you, they're going to take you and they're going to put you back into the hands of God's will. And you're going to be able to walk in the worthiness of God. You're going to be able to do the things of God. And there are always going to be obstacles. There's always be hurdles in along the way. There's always going to be things trying to break you. But don't break under pressure, baby, because God will do whatever it takes to get you to where you are. He'll save you. He'll heal you. And he's going to use you. He used Moses. He used David. He used Job. He used Jacob. He used Abraham. He used Sarah. He used the woman with the issue of blood. He used the widow woman. He used the Shunammite woman. We can go through the whole Bible who God used, but sometimes he had to help him before he could heal him. He had to break him before he could bless him. He had to hurt him before he could heal him. Know that you're going through right now, but God is going to do whatever it takes to use you. May God bless you and may God keep you. If you have right now, we thank God. Maybe there's someone here today that would like to turn their life over to God. There's somebody here today that said, I've been out here too long. I want a closer relationship with God. I want God to use me. I want Him to heal me. I want God to deliver me. I want Him to save me. Maybe that's you today. Maybe that's you out there in Facebook land. To say I'm tired. I'm sick and tired of being the same way I used to be. I want God to heal my body. I want Him to forgive me. I'm not even worthy to stand in His presence. But Jesus said that I'm the good shepherd. And I lay my life down for you. So Jesus laid His life down for you. Many years ago, He went to the cross just for you. So that you can have life. That you can be made whole. And God is making you whole right now. Because He'll do whatever it takes. And even doing whatever it takes, it's called putting His Son on the cross so that you can be saved. His Son went on the cross. God will do whatever it takes to make sure that you shall live. Do whatever it takes that you can fulfill your purpose in life. And we thank you. So if that's you, just lift up your hands and just say, Lord, receive me. Lord, receive me. I want you to do whatever it takes to save me, Lord. I want you to do whatever it takes to heal me, Lord. I want you to do whatever it takes to use me, Lord. I'm willing. I'm open. My mind, my heart, my soul cries out to you, Lord. I need you right now, God. I need you right now, God. I need you right now, God. Look beyond my fault and see my need. Lord, we need you right now. Somebody need to be healed this morning. Somebody need to be saved this morning. We need you, God. If that's you and you said that, God is open now. And He's ready to do whatever it takes to save you. He's already done it. He's already done it. He sent His Son just for you so that you can live and you can have life and you can fulfill your purpose. Now, we thank you right now. If that's you, celebrate God. Celebrate your deliverance. Celebrate your breakthrough. Celebrate, celebrate. And God is willing to do whatever it takes to save you. Maybe you're here today and you want to sow into the ministry. You want to sow and seed. Our Cash App is the ICOG. Hashtag the ICOG, or you can use Tithely. It should be on the screen. If it's not on the screen, the ICOG cash app is hashtag the THEICOG. We're looking forward to you. If this ministry or this word has blessed you this morning, please don't forget to sow, pay your tithes, go into Tithely. We'll be blessed. We thank you for sowing to the ministry. Because God is making a way that we can do bigger and greater things. And we don't take it lightly that you have sold and have sown into this ministry. Because God is doing great things for our leader, Pastor Leroy G. Carroll Jr. and the membership at the Inspiration Church of God. And we thank you today. We thank you for this time. And we ask that you go out and reach out to somebody else. And do whatever it takes. Do whatever it takes to help somebody else. Be like God. Do whatever it takes to get somebody from where they are to where you want them to be and where God is calling them to be. May God bless you and may God keep you. Be blessed. Yes.
You